Well, the Robert C. Williams Paper Museum at Georgia Tech is a really fun and interesting place to visit. And we're not very well known in Atlanta. We're much better known internationally and nationally. And we have the largest collection of paper and paper-related articles in the world. We cover the history of papermaking from 4000 BC to 200 BC when we have pre-paper. And then we go from 200 BC to modern times. We even have the paper that was made out in outer space aboard the Columbia space shuttle. One of the most interesting artifacts in the museum are palm leaf books. And these were things that were used for writing and for books before we had papermaking. These particular ones are from Thailand and Tibet. And they took the palm leaf and cut it into a rectangular shape, took a knife and carved in the writing, and they put soot in the writing. And so they rubbed it in so that you could see where they had written on it. And the holes were strung along a metal prong, and they made a book out of the palm leaves. And even when they had paper in Thailand, they kept the shape of the palm leaves. And when you have the expression leaf of a book, this is where it comes from, because they were actually leaves in the books. These are Batak books. They're from Sumatra, Indonesia, and they're made out of pounded wood. And they pounded the wood out, and then they took the berry juice, and they took the ink from the fire, and they made it so they could write on the books. One of the coolest things about these books is that when you read it, you read all the way through one direction, it's one book, and you turn it over and read all the way through the second direction, it's a second book. And these particular books are talking about using the insides of roosters for divination. Papermaking started in 200 BC in China, and the first paper was made out of recycled fishing nets, bamboo, and hemp. And they dug a large hole in the ground and lined it with stones and put a layer of hemp, which is what fishing net was made out of, and a layer of lime, and a layer of hemp, and a layer of lime. And they put it all in water and let it rot for 3 months. They brought it back out, pounded it, separated the fibers, spread it out, and let the whole thing out in sunshine to dry. So when papermaking went to Japan, they started making out of kozo, Mitsumata, and gampi. And kozo is what we call mulberry trees. They'd steam them in a wooden barrel, they'd pick off the bark, which is called chiri, they'd pound it out, and they'd make paper. And they still do it that same way in the papermaking villages in Japan. Well, among the many workshops we offer is one on washi. And washi means Japanese hand papermaking. And it's a wonderful workshop where people learn how to take the sticks, the mulberry sticks, and they learn how to steam them and pound them so that they get the fiber separated. They learn what a sugeta is, which is a Japanese paper mold, and they learn how to make paper the Japanese way.
And there's this whole rhythm of making Japanese paper that's very different from Western, where you create this wavefront within your mold and you've got to watch this wavefront move back and forth. And it's this timing to try to make it bounce from one end to the other. To do it properly, it's actually very zen-like. You have to be so focused on the frame and the water and the movements that you're almost not thinking about it at all. You're just reacting to how the water is moving.
I'm a third grade teacher, and early last year we had the opportunity to bring the children in to make some paper, and upon doing it, I became absolutely enthralled with it. And so coming up on my first year anniversary, I said to myself, you know, since traditionally it's symbolized by paper, what better way to earmark the year than to make paper? And so I came in for a couple of the Japanese paper making classes, and I made paper for my lovely wife, Jamila. And I said, you know, let me take it a step further. We should make paper together. And so after that, I signed us up. You know, it's just really slow paced, and you know, the fibers of inside of the water feel so smooth and gentle. It just kind of takes you to another place, and so I guess it's therapeutic for me. That's what I enjoy about it the most.
I think the most interesting thing about learning to make paper is thinking about papermaking in general and the history and how much goes into every little piece of paper that was used. And so now when I think about paper, I can't even imagine that it's processed and you know as much as we waste when I think about how much time actually goes into making one sheet. It's given me a new appreciation for it.
Most people don't understand where paper comes from. They just think, you know, you go to the Staples or whatever, an office supply store, and buy yourself a pack of paper, and you throw it into your copier, or inkjet printer. But there's a lot to it. There's a lot of science to it. There's a lot of things you can do to paper to make it different for different processes. And it's really nice to be able to come to the Paper Museum and see how that has evolved, because it's really part of our culture. We wouldn't have grown as a civilization without being able to pass information from one person to the next.
Well, the history of papermaking is fascinating. I truly, really enjoy it. I think it has a lot for everybody. We've got kidnappings and art and slavery and all sorts of things all bound up in the history of papermaking, and the museum tells that story. People can learn a lot of history, they can learn a lot of anthropology, and they can learn just how paper is made and how important it is into your lives.